When I saw it pinned on the notice board at the club, I thought it had to be some kind of practical joke. Speed dating for seniors. The only thing that happens quickly at our age is dementia. Now, I'm a happily married woman and hadn't even contemplated attending, but, well, as chance would have it, I found myself passing by the event some weeks later and curiosity got the better of me. So I go in for a little look-see. And it's filled with all these women, all primed and plucked and held together with Botox and spandex control pants, all sitting cross-legged at these little tables with their skirts hitched up, just enough to show that their libido isn't incognito. And the men, not one under 80, struggling up from their chairs onto walking sticks or Zimmer frames, squinting so badly through cataracts that they wander off to the wrong table, having conversations they're too deaf to hear, and no memory to remember they've sat with the same woman three times. Dear old Bob told me all about his bladder infection. Harold asked me if my hair was real, and Jim rolled his dentures around like he was sucking on gumballs. And as others just babbled away, I just sat there, pitying these sad, sad souls, all just wanting to feel less alone for a moment. And I thought, you know what I would do if I were in charge of the speed dating? I'd run proceedings like a restaurant sushi train. I'd put all the men on the conveyor belt and let the women pick out the ones that still smelt fresh. But a bell rings and the men move and I hear the clickety-clackety of Gumball Jim coming back for a second bite. So I grab my handbag and stand, just as this gentleman sits down. Three-piece suit. Nails trimmed, no colostomy bag bulging out his trousers. He introduces himself as Leon and he says, "Do you believe in being fair?" I nod hesitantly as he stares right at me with this little half smile and he says, "Well, gorgeous, you've had that incredible body your entire life. Isn't it fair I have it for one night? Let me tell you, I've never been propositioned before. Didn't happen in my day. I held nothing but a man's hand until Albert put a ring on mine. Married for 52 years. And the only thing a man ever offered me was a seat on the bus. But the next thing I know, Leon and I are in the back seat of a taxi. Now, I'm a rational woman. God knows, I certainly don't go around picking up strange men. In my time of life, I barely have the energy to pick up my medication. But the next thing I know, we're sharing a hip flask. Coughing over the home brew and laughing like a couple of naughty school kids. Catch the driver smirking at us in his rear view mirror. What on earth am I doing? At the next red light, I'll apologise to Leon and make a less than dignified exit. But every light is green, intersection after intersection, like some greater force is driving me forwards. And as I lean towards the driver's ear to ask him to please pull over, Leon leans towards mine and he says, "Don't do anything that makes you feel uncomfortable. I'm paying the driver for the night. He'll take you home anytime you like." Maybe he just wants companionship, to hug, to feel that warmth of another human being. feel less alone for a moment. That's not cheating, right? I'm merely being a good Samaritan. So I take another sip from his hip flask. Oh, we book him to this lavish 5-star hotel as Mr. and Mrs. Bum smells. The snooty-nosed man types in our details asking, how do we spell bum smells? And Leon, completely straight-faced, replies, B-U-M, as in backside, hyphen, S-M-E-double-L-S, as in odour. It's Dutch. My family were in the baked bean business. As the elevator doors close, we burst into hysterics. Oh, tears down our cheeks, literally clutching at our bellies. Oh, I haven't laughed that hard since. As we settle, the silence leaves just music. I catch Leon's eye in the mirror. He grabs my hand. It's soft. He rubs his thumb across my clammy palm. I think he wants more than companionship. He leads me down this long, plush corridor towards our penthouse suite. We pass walls lined with portraits of regal men, their eyes tracking me. What must they be thinking? What on earth am I thinking? I could catch God knows what. You read about things like that. I've known Dr. Goldberg for 38 years. What's he going to think when I turn up with chlamydia? Smiling, Leon extends his arm, letting me into the suite first. Winking, he excuses himself to freshen up, like I need him any fresher. I move over to the balcony and stare out at the city lights. And picture Albert sitting in the bay room window. I look at the front door. Escape is closer than the bedroom. I stand there thinking. And then I walk to Leon. He's by the bed, smiling. I move towards him, my knees shaking like I'm tiptoeing a tightrope between two tall skyscrapers. And I say, Leon, I never intended to come to the speed dating. He moves towards me, wrapping an arm around the small of my back. His breath is warm against my neck as he whispers. I watched you take down the flyer from the notice board. He takes my hand as he gently hums. Doo-bee-doo-bee-doo, bee-doo-bee-doo-bee-doo-bee-doo-bee-doo. And as this tornado of guilt inside my head slowly begins to lose its breath, I drift. I let go. I let go. I let go. I sit alone in the back seat of the taxi. Every light is red as we crawl through morning peak hour. I spray Chanel Mamzelle on my wrist, rub my neck. It's Albert's favourite perfume. He's sitting in the bay room window, staring blank-faced. I move towards him and stand by his side, listening to his heavy breath. Taking his hand, I unclench it from the dressing gown I'd ironed a day earlier. It's cold, and I cry. Remembering that day, 9 years ago when he was moved into care. He started to slip away from me. How he said, visit me, love me, but promise me you'll let me go. You have to let me go.
My name is Jacqueline Hume, and I will be performing a monologue written by me, named Beautiful Burden. Je suis noire. I am black. I didn't know I was black. Honest. I had no idea there was such a thing as color, as racism, as prejudice because of one's race. I only knew mom and dad, my siblings, my family, my best friends, Melanie and Awa, who were Salvadorian and Senegalese, my neighbor Sam, who was American, my classmates who came from all over the world and who were different shades and colors. How could I know such evil? Or maybe how could I not know? I came from a well-to-do family. A diplomat's daughter, private school education, upbringing in different countries all over the world, accustomed to dealing with different kinds of people from all kinds of backgrounds. I liked someone because of who they were, and I didn't like someone for the same reasons. It was as simple as that. There were hushed conversations and lingering thoughts in movies and TV shows that talked about racism, but it wasn't real. At least, it was not real to me. What was colorism? What was bias? Did people really hate others because of the color of their skin? Because of a cover they had not chosen for themselves? Because of a color that only God could have known? It could not be. Don't worry, or maybe do. I did not stay happily ignorant for long. U.S. history would not deem it so, and if that was not enough, I experienced it myself. The first time I felt my blackness and was faced with racism was in Portland, Oregon. Portland. A liberal city, a city of hippies, of peace and love and pacifism. A city of whites. A city with hidden agendas and secret hate. My sister and I were walking down the street, minding our own business, walking from the park back to our uncle's place. Up ahead was a mother and her daughter walking in front of us. We didn't really pay attention to them. We were both chatting excitedly. As the mother and daughter passed us, I heard the daughter say, "What is that?" My sister looked up, shocked, and asked me, "Did she just say that?" "I'm sure it was nothing," I replied. "Maybe it's the first time she had ever seen black people. Don't worry about it." The second time was more insidious, more in your face, more traumatic. My sister and I were walking again on the long, sinuous road back to my uncle's house. We were chatting, laughing, and joking, not really paying attention to our surroundings. No real care outside of our bubble. as a blue van drove up. It neared us slowly. And suddenly, a window came down. Young male voices could be heard using words I dare not repeat. And a white hand armed with a large cup filled with sugary liquid was thrown in our direction before they sped away. This was not late at night. We were not scantily clad. It was the middle of the day, the early afternoon, in fact. The sun was shining gloriously, and these boys wanted to humiliate us because of our color, because of our race, because of our blackness in the light of day. I did not cry. I did not scream. I didn't even get angry, to be honest. I was just sad and numb. I had never thought that being Black was difficult or scary or soul-crushing. I thought it was the same as being white, tan, brown, or any shade thereof. I was wrong. Being Black in the United States and in the world is what I would call a beautiful burden. I didn't know I was Black. But now, every day, I know, I feel, I see, I sense my Blackness. I am Black. Je suis noir.
Fell asleep in my tea last night. Face planted right on the plate. So bloody shattered. Claire couldn't stop laughing. Mash stuck on me lashes. Gravy matted in me fringe. Coming round, not knowing where I was for a second. Is he safe? Did I forget to collect his prescriptions? Looking down at what looked like a kid's drawing of me stupid face. She was howling now, tears streaming down her cheeks, just about to whip out her phone to take a picture. My instant reaction was to cry. Big, blobby toddler tears. Cold gravy dripping down me top. Why didn't you check I was all right first? I felt like I had a hangover. Reality kicked in. We were still in lockdown. Nothing makes much sense anymore. Can't warm up. You know, I've never felt this dog tired. Even after I had Simon. That was a walk in the park compared to this. I must have looked daft. Claire wasn't being unkind. She apologised and asked if I was okay. I just mumbled, fine. We're all a bit delirious, to be fair. Meetings going on behind closed doors, not looking each other in the eye. I keep holding my breath without realising. Are they talking about me? Christ, I think I snorted myself awake. No wonder she was laughing. The shame of it. As if we haven't got enough to contend with. I was just starting to feel like part of the gang. So embarrassing. Back to being that one again. Do-gooder. Novelty act. No one's actually said that. They've all been really nice. It's me. Maybe I've gone a step too far. Pete's face when I told him. Who am I kidding? What right do I have to step into their world? Cold mash is actually really comfortable. Feels warm and safe. They all came in to see me one by one. Karen said I could have her room in the Alex. Sarah automatically put the kettle on. Brewing up fixes everything. And Sylvie, the senior, just sighed and said, "We can't get rid of you now, can we?" I met her first. We had the initial chat about me plan. She must have thought I was mad. I didn't flinch when they mentioned tests and assessments. This wasn't going to be a holiday. I knew that. He was all that mattered. You only get one dad. I knew I was doing the right thing as long as he was okay. They all had to be safe too. I wasn't being totally selfish, but it was my first instinct. It's become so much more. I actually enjoy it. Never thought I'd say that. Always been a bit snobby about that kind of work. Didn't mean to be. Everyone was like that or didn't even think. Unskilled and low pay. That's how they were labelled. Care workers. The kind of job the work shy don't want and immigrants take on to stay here. Well, that's what we've always been told. Shocking. Who put up with that? Better to work at Morrison's than have to deal with catheters and hoists. Clapping on Thursday nights. What a joke. As if that suddenly makes years of neglect all right. Holding my breath again. Makes us want a tab. You could call it an assignment. I'm hardly Marie Colvin. I wish I was. She was incredible. Maybe in another life. I'm not sure working on a local newspaper qualifies as a war zone. I do love it, though. It might appear small and pedestrian to some, but it's right at the heart of the community. It matters. When I was put on furlough, I knew that I had to find a way to see him. The urge was so strong. Couldn't be left. Not on my watch. When we moved him into Maplewood Lodge, he resented it. I know he did. Couldn't look me in the eye. What choice did we have? He was getting worse, shutting down. Tremors were off the scale. He couldn't keep fobbing us off. The kettle would go flying, hot water shooting in all directions. Terrible burns. First name terms with the paramedics. He needed specialist care. I think my mum would have liked it there, on the edge of Fulwell Quarry Nature Reserve. She would have spotted the big and the small skipper. Bit of a butterfly expert. They would have loved walking through the wildflower meadows. This isn't going to be the rest of my life. I'm not stopping being a reporter. It's temporary. Like they keep telling us, this is a chance to volunteer. Something I've been meaning to do for years, I just never got round to it. I got through all the tests. There were 8 of them in total, and they lasted 90 minutes each. Zoom's knackering, isn't it? DBS check to follow. I kept pushing to see if there was any way to speed up the process. Daily calls, weekly email to check in. Surely they needed me in their ASAP. My pushiness didn't go down too well. Not surprising, really. I just didn't understand why the checks were taking forever. All we can do is wait. All we can do is wait, Diane. All we can do is wait, Miss Hopgood. As each day passed by, as each week dragged on, I felt like this was all just a stupid idea. Maybe I should just be doing yoga with Adrienne or adopting a dog. Instead, I binged all 8 seasons of Homeland, made the obligatory banana bread, and I missed him more than words could say. I'd all but given up. Simon was isolating with his dad. Lockdown happened on his week. Didn't want to disrupt him. Andy's all over it. Shit husband, but a good dad. We FaceTime every day. He's always liked him more anyway. I've always been close. I've sat in the car outside Andy's place. We've had chats. Well, I've sat with the car door open and Simon sat on the front step with his AirPods in. Not much dazzling conversation. Felt good though. To actually see him. They seem to be surviving on dominoes. At least we have that in common. I explained that I might not be around for a while. He just shrugged and turned his music up. On the way back to mine, I got the call from Kathy, the manager. Had to pull over. I didn't want it to go to voicemail. The DBS had come through. We were good to go. I was going to be one of their leisure activity coordinators on a different unit to me dad. Same site. Once I'd finished all my daily duties, I could spend an hour with him. 8 a.m. start tomorrow and I'll need you to move in. Does that make a difference? No. I'll do whatever it takes. Mind jumps into overdrive. Last check in the mirror to pull away. I'm beaming. It worked. Peach thinks I won't last the day. It's little brother's for you. I've got a big box of disposable masks on the back seat. Can I really do this? You have the most wonderful bum. That was me intro to Clive. 90 and an absolute ladies man. Apparently he thought it'd be women on tap when he moved in. I was fair game as newest recruit. Not sure asking them what activities they'd like me to plan was a good idea, though. Doris wants to do a skydive. Bernard wants to learn salsa. Shirley wants to meet Rylan. We all know what Clive wants. I was thinking more. Tea dances and whist drives. Who knows what a whist drive actually is anyway? They all make me laugh. I hope I'm a good distraction. They don't seem nervous at all. We decide on a freedom party. They'll make the invitation, the buntings and the cakes, all ready for when lockdown's over. Friends and family will pack out the place. I might even organise a salsa lesson. This is the exact moment. I feel uneasy. A wolf in sheep's clothing. They don't know yet that Stan is me dad. I'm not keeping it from them. I'm just not sure it helps. I don't want to look like I'm playing at it. 7 days until I can have contact with me dad. Starting to feel a bit like I'm undercover. Sarah made a pasta bake last night. We all just about managed to eat at the same time. Sylvie was last to the table. Sheila won't settle without her. We all sat in silence. Still not properly looking each other in the eye. As if holding each other's gaze for longer than a second might reveal too much. Nobody can warm up. Constantly on the edge. Exhausted. This could be the best thing to happen to this place. Everyone looks at Clay, stunned. Well, come on. The karma for the most part. Must be seeing the same faces every day. They're all eating better. Can't remember the last time I had a meal at the table. We know each other properly now. You don't do mornings. Now everyone's looking at me. Claire shoots me a look. My heart stops for a second. Have I gone too far? The room erupts in laughter. Sylvie smiles at me. Looks like I do fit in now. You shouldn't be here, putting folks at risk. What were you thinking? Not quite the reunion I'd hoped for. They look terrified. This is you all over. Nice to see you too, Dad. I'm allowed. I work here. Showing him the badge on me top. He looked baffled. I've been tested. No symptoms. Following all the guidelines. Safe. He looks away. I thought you'd be pleased. I've been so scared, love. Didn't think I'd ever see you again. Everything in me being has to stop myself. I cross my arms, pushing hard. I want to run to him, hug him, hold his hand, kiss his cheek. I take a deep breath. I'm here now, Dad. I'll see you every day. He turns to me, eyes wet. Can we go for a walk? Not yet. I want to show you something. He gestures to his walker. I guide it round to him. Struggling, he leans onto the frame, pulling himself halfway up. It's agony to stand by, just watching. One last push, Dad. Slowly, he manages to stand. I want you to meet a couple of my pals. He moves across to the big picture window. I position myself on the other side. We're like bookends. Do you need me to get them from their rooms? No, they're here already. My stomach drops. I knew it'd get worse. Just hoped it hadn't got to that stage yet. Nancy's by the table. Frank's lurking by the trees. Do you need your eyes testing? Cheeky sod. I stare out of the glass, following his directions to the letter. There's no one at the table. Deserted. Hang on. What's that on the paving? I start chuckling. There she is. Nancy with a laughing face. A vivid green neck feathers catching the light. Frank is sauntering round the rest of the garden, looking for the rest of the rat pack. His magnificent blue-green train winking at us. They live here too. Make a right racket. Feels like we're somewhere exotic with them around. On an adventure. He looks across at me, eyes twinkling. Glad you're here, pet. My dad. Wine gums and fivers. That's him. Always had a tube on the go. Generously giving away the green ones whilst quietly stashing away the reds. Pressing a fiver into me pocket to treat myself whenever I went round to the house. I spent 2 more days like this. Watching him singing away to himself. Telling me that Nancy keeps giving him the eye. Belly laughing at that advert with a talking dog. Sylvie stops me on the way back to the staff room. We need to move your dad upstairs. What? I've just seen him. It's urgent. He needs extra support. He stopped eating and he's refusing to drink. Well, I can sort that out. Just let me go back and see him. He has a new cough. Well, surely it's better. Diane, we need to move your dad into quarantine. He's a COVID risk. This is essential to protect everyone. I don't know what happened next. I woke up with Claire holding me hand. Tried to get up and the whole room spun. Steady, you fainted. Claire's by me side. Let's just sit here for a more, get our bearings. Sarah passes me a glass of water. It's my fault. What are you on about? I must have made a mill. Claire and Sarah flash each other a look. They're a bit too slow with the denial. It's no one's fault. They keep telling me that. Claire found the food on her afternoon rounds. He'd been hiding it in his cardigan pockets. Trails of it around the garden. Frank and Nancy mustn't have been partial. As if he was leaving crumbs to find his way home. I woke up at 2 a.m. in the annex. Had to get out. Boiling hot. My head was about to explode. Walking across the courtyard, I could see the strip lights blinking across the corridor at the top of the main house. He's up there. Curtains drawn. Bedside lamp on. Not detected. It's here on the app. Negative. I had a drive-through test. Nurse in full PPE kit. I haven't touched anyone. Not even my own son. Ordered everything online. This can't be happening. I sat out all night, watching his room. Willing him to get through this. Begging for it to be something else. Sarah brought me out a brew at dawn. She couldn't sleep either. We sat in silence. Light changing from night to day. There was movement. Gnawing at me hands. A rush of activity along the corridor. Sarah ran to the stairs. I can't hold it in. The lamp went out. I let out a scream. Couldn't stop myself. Peacocks howled. Pete won't talk to me. He made all the arrangements. Didn't ask what I think. Emailed all the details across. Only close family. Requested that I let him know if I'll be attending. That's where we are at the moment. There's a link to watch it online. I didn't do anything wrong. I was just trying to be there for my dad. We don't know exactly. Andy and Simon sent me a Domino's the other night. Broke me heart. So lovely. Sylvie said I can take all the time I need. Postmortem's been delayed by a fortnight. There's a backlog. You'll be bagged up like hazardous waste. I can't stop watching the news. The daily briefings. Why aren't they doing anything? The care homes are on their knees and Maplewood Lodge is no different. At breaking point and running out of PPE. Or is it easier just to kill off all the older population than to fork out to properly care for them? Starting to go in now. My Simon by the doors. I think he's looking for me. His hair's got long. This'll be his first funeral. He was too young when... Okay. I have to do this. Everything'll be all right. Pete'll pretend I don't exist. This is important. Simon needs me. I've got form at funerals. Bottled it at me mum's. Well, I nearly did. They're about to start and I'd gone AWOL. My dad found it sat in the memorial garden reading all the cards on the flowers. I can't do this. It's too much. Come here. We sat on a bench, facing out, holding hands tightly. I know you can do this. You are my daughter, and you are one of a kind. There's no one quite like you. Just like that. He makes me believe in myself. I know. It's time, isn't it?
I started to see things weren't quite right years ago. There were all these planes crisscrossing the sky. This was then, before. There were so many of them, long plumes in the sky. I read about this man in a microlight. It's one of those sail things with an engine somewhere. I can't remember. And suddenly, this thing just fell out the sky. No reason, just like that. They said he'd run out of fuel. But when he crashed, there was a huge fire. People said they heard the engine running as he fell. I mean, how could there have been a fire if he'd run out of petrol? Then I read on the internet about these chemtrails. They spray something, these planes. It's what you see in the vapour trails. It's something poisonous. It's not good for you. I'm not sure what it does, but I know it's there. People laughed at me when I told them. Don't be so gullible, they said. They're just vapour trails, jet planes. But if that story's true about the microlight, it makes you think. I mean, it was years ago, but it's been at the back of my mind for ages. It's niggled. All these allergies nowadays, people getting ill, the environment. Something's going on. We moved here a couple of years back. We used to be in a village, but everyone talked about us, Reg and me. Not to us, but behind our backs. It was something and nothing, but it got to us. When we went in the shop, conversation just stopped, like they were talking about us. I know we're a bit different. Reg had a good job. He was on the base. Not a pilot or anything glamorous. Security. General dog's body. 20 years of it. But he's got a pension. He had to be smart. But since then, he's got all these tattoos. Crazy bugger. I never had a job, not a proper one. That's what my mum always said. I made things, sold them at markets. Pin money. Anyway, after Reg left work, we decided to up sticks and live in a van. Reg fitted it out. It was comfortable, with a bed and a kitchen. We even had a wood burner. Didn't have a loo, but we had a shovel. We thought we'd see a bit of the country after all the years living in flatlands out in Suffolk. It was great. Scotland, the lakes, down to Cornwall, Wales, anywhere we could stop. Sometimes they moved us on. I suppose people thought we were a threat. Travellers, gippos. We lived on nothing. Wonderful times. We had 5 years in that van. Then we thought we'd come off the road, stop travelling. We found an old wreck of a building in Wales. Bit isolated, but we liked that. We scraped the money together and made a nice place to settle down. Reg did the building work, just like he'd done with the van. We had running water. Well, a stream, a loo, solar panels. and the internet. Where would I be without Facebook? I've never been much good with technology. I leave that up to Reg. But Facebook's so easy. And the friends you make. I joined loads of groups. Animals, nature. I even joined a knitting group. I haven't knitted for ages. I thought I might pick it up again during lockdown. Dream on. There's one that's right up my street. Living off grid. Fantastic. Full of really good advice. People are always willing to share what they know. People you've never met. I've got 75 new friends off it. One bloke, Dave. Oh, it's been really good. He's got the same outlook on life as me. He says he was something in finance, then gave it all up to live different. Good on him. Didn't take long to start chatting on WhatsApp. There we are, putting the world to rights. And suddenly he'll say, Marion, I've got something to send you. And ping, there'll be a link in the text box. It's always interesting. Makes me think. I need that. Did I say we've got a daughter? She's mine, not by Reg. Another bloke when I was 19. Crystal. We lost touch in the van years. But she'd gone by the time we left. Went to the bright lights. When I say we lost touch, we do keep up. She's settled down now, somewhere in Cornwall. She knows where we are. Yeah, got our email, phone. Yeah, I miss her. And the kid. It's Justin. It's my grandson. It upsets me, but Reg was never one for children. And after we'd done the house, we did the land. We wanted to be self-sufficient, live on what we could grow. And chickens, always chickens and eggs. Yeah, it's not well, the little boy. Sick. Well, I say sick, but it's more like it's in his head. He's 5 now, well, going on 6. But when he was 3, he started to scream and shout. Crystal sent me videos. It was obvious he wasn't well. One of the videos showed him banging his head into the chair, just shouting, bang, 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 that little head of his just thumping into the seat of the chair. It was that vaccine they give him. MMR. Dave told me about it. Crystal said it was just the way it worked out. One of those things. He's autistic. But I know. Because she told me the doctor forced her to have the jab. They just gave it to him. No messing. It's as clear as day on the internet. Reg told me when the forces were in the Gulf, they had to have all these injections. Not him, he wasn't there, but when they got back, he picked it all up in the canteen. They'd been made to have them. No one knew what it was. Officially, it was a cocktail, not a bloody gin and tonic, I can tell you. Same with the vaccine they gave Justin. No one knows, but that's what caused it. All the head banging. They know. They always knew. Social experiment that went wrong. Same with the virus. Who knows where it comes from? During the first lockdown, I spent hours on the internet trying to find out. Reg was outside doing what he does, tinkering, bit of gardening, building a new shed. Oh, they're full of old car bits. He loves his cars. But I was inside. I had to find out. I needed to. Locked down, locked up, locked out, told what to do. Fact is, I don't know anyone who's had it. Not even sure it's real. One of the things Dave and me talked about is 5G. Reg learned on the base, radio waves could be really dangerous. They'd been warned not to get too close to the nose cones, where the radar is. It could fry you alive. 5G, just as bad. I read all this stuff. How they have to wear special suits up the masts. Dave sent me a message about a big march in Birmingham. Now, I am not a demonstration person. I didn't go on any of those marches about the Iraq thing. That's what Reg was doing, how he was earning his money. I wasn't about to complain. But I talked to Reg about it, the march. Said we might go. I wasn't sure if he'd be up for it. But he was. I said we might meet up with my Facebook friend. Be funny to meet him in the flesh. We went in the van, found somewhere to park up. I mean, that was hard because they put up all these barriers to stop vans getting in. Lots of places. It's typical somehow. Anyway, we parked up and took the bus into town. Amazing. So many people. Not just the types you see on the telly waving banners and shouting. People like us, ordinary people, concerned. I hadn't hope in hell of bumping into Dave. We hadn't made any arrangement. We got loads of leaflets, went back with a stack of them, and speeches. Oh, we were miles back in the crowd, but they had these big loudspeakers up by the podium. There was a nurse who'd been sacked for speaking out against what was going on. She said 5G was causing the virus. I can believe that. Someone talked about how we were all going to be forced to be vaccinated. How Bill Gates, you know, Microsoft, was planning to put a chip into everyone on the planet. You won't find that in the newspapers. And then at the end, this man came to the front. He was the last speaker. Everyone cheered. He was brilliant. It was like a breath of fresh air about how the government was keeping things from us, how there was a plan. How it was all secret, but he knew. He'd found out. Things I never imagined. Really frightening. We're being lied to. It's all about control. 5G, children disappearing, the virus, the vaccinations. He said the virus was man-made. I believe him. It makes so much sense. These things don't just appear out of nowhere. He showed how all the bits of the puzzle fit together. He called it the New World Order. That's what they want. And they're using the virus to get their way, just like that. It's breathtaking, horrifying. I'm really angry about all this. What have we done to deserve it? Reg doesn't say much, but I could see him nodding. He must know things from the base he's never told me. It all fits. I'm not wearing this anymore. You can go to prison if you don't. According to Dave, lots of people have been arrested for not wearing one. When the man at the meeting said everyone should take theirs off, I could see people hesitating. Not that many people were wearing them. I took mine off. The couple next to me did. And then everyone did. Just ripping them off and chucking them on the ground. Mind control. That's what it is. It felt like liberation. The square was littered with masks when we left. Like confetti. We got back to the van, drove home. Since then, I've been going through the leaflets. Amazing. I never realised how much we were being controlled. Living like we do, quite remote, I thought we were free, independent. But we're not. Slaves. Slaves to a secret cabal. Pawns. When she was a kid, Crystal came home from school and said, "Mum, are we prawns?" I said, "What?" "Prawns," she said. "Mr. Bailey at school said we were all like prawns in a bigger game." The penny dropped. She meant pawns. I said, "No, that's silly. You're Crystal. You're not a pawn." But she was right. We are pawns in a bigger game, and they don't want us to know the rules. But I'm beginning to, and I'm angry. Fucking furious. Most people's eyes are closed. They just don't want to know. I learnt so much at that meeting in Birmingham. It makes my head spin what's going on. How could we have been so blind not to see the truth, the facts, how it's all connected? The planes in the sky, the radio waves, the stuff they put in the water, the vaccinations. There's a new mask going up near us. God knows what it will do to us. I want to burn it down. It's got to stop. People like us have got to rise up before it's too late. Who else is going to if we don't? There were 30,000 people at least at that rally. Only the telly said it was 5. I was there. There were thousands. Another lie. Mainstream media lies. Oh, thank God for the internet. I wouldn't begin to know any of this without it. A little while back, Crystal called. Just out the blue. She sounded really up. Not like I've heard her in a long time. Said they're putting Justin on a new treatment. Behavioural therapy. I cut her off. "That's how it all started," I said. Silence. "Are you there?" I said. "Yes, Mum, I'm listening. What are you trying to say to me?" I said, "Injections is how it all started. That MMR stuff, that's what caused it. And now you're going to let them give him more?" Well, I got an earful then. "Mum, this is nothing to do with injections. Anyway, you know what I think? We've been through all this before. This treatment's going to help him. I've discussed it with them." Well, that really got me going. I let fly. I told her she shouldn't be so stupid. She was trusting them. Did she have any idea what she was doing? I told her about the meeting in Birmingham. And then she shouted at me, "You were there at that rally in Birmingham with all those crazy people, conspiracies about this and that, all that nonsense." Oh, it got worse after a real shouting match on the phone. She accused me of going down the rabbit hole, that it was all nonsense, that I was being lied to for God knows what reason. "They're lying to your mum, don't fall for it." Lying to me, eh? I know who's lying, and it's not them. We slammed the phone down on each other. My own daughter, my flesh and blood, and she can't see. I've had it up to here. I've read the book. But she hasn't even opened the cover. I got straight on to Dave. I knew he'd know what to do. He'd tell me what to say to her to make her believe. He'd have another fact. Something she didn't know. But he's vanished. And his Facebook page is gone. Even his WhatsApp's not working. They must have got him. They must have. That was weeks ago. I've heard nothing. I don't want to lose her. I brought her into this world. I know you think I'm crazy, but I'm trying to tell you something important. Like I told you to look both ways when you cross the road. Like not talking to strangers. Can't I get even you to understand? Don't you see? I'm angry. More angry than I've ever been. Not with you, sweetie. The world. Such a shit place. Crystal. Let me in.
No, stay. Stay, why is she leaving? Is it a she even? I can't tell from here, just get her back. Get her back. Try. Please, just try. Without her, you've got no chance, mate. So just do something. Right, wave your arms about or shout or scream. Just do something for God's sake. Sorry. I didn't mean to shout at you. It's just she's not coming back, is she? No, I don't know. Maybe they take turns. I can't tell. I'm still figuring this situation out. All she seems to do is check the monitors and press the buttons that go beep, beep, beep. 3 times. Always. This time they didn't beep. And she didn't wait to write anything down on a clipboard. Well, it's not looking good, is it? Well, come on. Challenge me like you always do. Anything I say, you say the opposite. That's how it's always been, right? If she comes back, I mean, when she comes back, it's game over, more or less. Unless you help them. Let them know that you're still in there. Unless you fight. You hear me? Imagine I'm right there taunting you to do something. Just do something. Can you hear me? No, this much I know you can hear me. Okay. Try this then. Make beautiful pictures in your head. Your brain can handle that. That's what I do. I replace the madness with beauty. I know you can hear me. So listen, you can't block me out, you can't interrupt, you can't wag your finger at me, spitting out every swear word in every language that you know. None of that. You are in my captive audience. You are in my thrall. I can't tell if you disapprove Yeah, hate my laugh. It really winds you up. Clip on the ear, kind of wind up, but it doesn't take much to wind you up. No matter what, you always wanted to know what was going on in here. Even in the middle of some red face and spitting and spewing spite, you always wanted to know what I was thinking. You're curious about what made me tick. Well, not now, obviously. Now it's just us. Look at you. Invaded and snatched of your everyday life. Looking like some pod person. And pod is far more subtle word than bubble. Well, maybe bubble sounds cozier and more bearable. Things were different. We'd be in the same bubble. Do you think? Remember the pod people. Invasion of the Body Snatchers, only a classic. The 1956 version, black and white. All science film. All science fiction films should be filmed in black and white. Makes it more real, somehow. And then the cheesy Donald Sutherland remake and the 1993 one, not great, but had its moments. I still watched it. It's the central metaphor that got me. An alien spore comes like a bad nightmare while you sleep and duplicates you until you, the original you, disintegrates to dust. You can't tell the real humans from the duplicates except for their lack of emotions. I found it strangely erotic, even at that age. I mean, what a film for a teenager. I'd watch it until the last credits rolled up like I was possessed. Now I know why. And that's why you never wanted to watch it. Because I loved it. 2 minutes in and you're yelling, Doctor Who ripoff! Cardboard actors in cardboard sets! Because I was obsessed with it. Because I got the metaphor and you didn't. How I loved saying metaphor and watching your face as you try to figure out the word. Failing to hide your stupid... your ignorance. Invasion of the Body Snatchers is not science fiction. Not for me. I knew that kind of paranoia. I knew that kind of fear. That feeling that something could come in the night and just steal the real me. I think of all the years when you thought I was the one invaded by an alien force. How helpless you felt, trying to figure me out. I understand that torture now. Now that the roles are reversed. Is she coming back? Oh, thank God she's coming back. Well, at least they're doing something. You know, activity's good. You've always hated stillness. You had to have the TV on all the time and the radio and God Save the Queen and the World Service and on and on. Any sign of her? No? Forgot to tell her to turn the volume up. There's no point wittering on if you can't hear me. I wish you had some vibrant colour around you. Some beauty. Everything just looks so industrial. I mean, I used to always make my room look beautiful, do you remember? Every time you thrashed it, I made it beautiful again. I've got this picture in my room. That's the first thing I see when I get up. It's not mine. It belongs to a friend. And this image has nearly every colour on it. It's a painting of two Hindu gods, or rather one body split into two halves. You've got the masculine side on the right and the feminine side embraced in union. It's real. I mean, this image dates back centuries. Lord Shiva and Parvati. It's real. People worship this beautiful image. Ardhanarishwara. It's not just male and female. It's all about the merging of the masculine energy with the feminine. I know all about Ardhanarishwara. It was like I was being held in that embrace. Not an alien invasion at all, just life and all its beauty. That image is everything. I see it everywhere I go. All this time, not knowing that the real me, essential me, is as old as time. But at last, I found it. Just in time. I nearly died that night. You know the night. You chucked me out, and you never wanted to see me again. There was that finality about your anger, like something inside of you finally broke. So yeah, everything I had in a bin bag and off I went. And just like you said to me so many times before, someday you'll find me lying in a ditch. And just like you said, it didn't take long. You see, the ugliness of life disgorges a person, or two, or three, or in my case, a drunken gang fueled by cheap booze and hate. Hate and hit after hit after hit until your head splits and your blood mingles with the dog shit on the cobble pavement. Maybe they didn't like the purple sequins on my dress. I was so proud of for stitching them on. Or maybe it was the glittery silver thigh-high boots that wind them up like crazy. Yeah, that brute force was somehow familiar. I lay there for a long time, thinking beautiful thoughts, until it all went dark. 38 stitches to reform the skull. Time healed the damaged nerves, and torn ligaments took months of physiotherapy. A patched up doll. Until slowly, I could dance again. No one can stop me from dancing. But you know that, don't you? Deep inside. That oatmeal beige wall, I can think of at least five ways to shut it up. Well, maybe you like it. It suits you, sir. You're not the type. You won't go gently into the night. That's what I thought. All these 5 years self-healing. I had it all planned out. The grand gesture. My unconditional, heartfelt forgiveness of you. I'll say I forgive you. Your face will screw up. Something bitter builds on your tongue. And I cower, secretly valiant as you lash out. That was the predictable dynamic. Not this pod person. That spore has grabbed you by the balls and it won't let go. Who'd have thought all this science fiction would prepare me for this? To boldly go where we, you and I, have never gone before. Perhaps seek destinies elsewhere. For now, we'll just sit and wait. Thank you.